bounty hunter after their opener.
And Lone Druid.
Lone Druid is still
Lone Druid is their top priority.
They want something juicy
Never mind.
Here.
Not happening. But you don't have to have expected this, right?
The
so now,
I was about to,
they could pick an offlaner, and now there's three out of the pool.
And then they could either go Bounty Hunter, they could also go the Enchantress, right? The Enchantress faces Void dual lane, which is quite strong versus Chen.
I like this approach. Now that they didn't target Puppy the way they did, I think this is a very good way of opening the draft.
Is it a Chen and Invoker then? Is it an Invoker at all, or are they going to prioritize Misery out of fear
they
that
They have
perhaps...
had a tendency to lean towards Invoker if the enemy team opens Void. Done it quite a bit, but they're taking a while, so maybe they want to do something else this time.
Those two heroes kind of counter each other, so it's not an awful matchup.
But... Yeah, I think it's mostly to deny the enemy team from getting both heroes, because then it's like usually always Xor, and the combo is ridiculous.
Are you still comfortable picking Invoker even in two of Faceless Void? That time dilation is pretty rough.
Well, that's why Syndra was saying they kind of counter each other. I think it's mainly just a synergy.
The newer play of Invoker, where you're going more Quest Wax, is more favorable versus Faceless Void than the Xor combo, which was a lot more detrimental. And as Draskal said, like the Xor combo with Faceless Void is actually one of the most powerful. If you can get some sort of global presence with a Void, it changes the way the hero works.
I think I picked Chen to have the highest win rate this tournament for any hero with over 5 picks, so go Secret.
Because, I mean, you first have to go to 5 picks.
Yeah, you need to get it 5 times. Generally, I think this hero has just been looking really strong in general. Especially because it's one of those heroes that has a chance of getting through in this exact scenario where you feel like you have to ban other heroes. You could argue Chen is, it's maybe good enough to give away Chen if you get like Earth Spirit or you get Invoker plus one or whatever in your phase, but you just, you can't ban everything. So, or if you get Prophet, I think Prophet is a very good trade for Chen too, but it's out. So. Good pickup here for Secret, I think. And now they're debating Invoker and...
Maybe Venge, too.
Venge? I think there's one more they're considering. I can't put my finger on it right now. There's...
That is Invoker, okay.
I think they might have thought about an offlaner for Misery already, so it doesn't get completely removed.
You know who we haven't seen much of this tournament yet, if at all, unless I've missed it, and I would love to see on eHome, is Kaka's Witch Doctor. I think we've seen a lot of Witch Doctor. Very good against the Chen, great with the Faceless Void.
That's a good pick.
You know, but surprisingly, just not really been in the light, but eHome,
I mean, this is not terribly surprising. eHome is one of like the three teams at this tournament that run Support Phoenix, and we're going to see a lot more of it, I think. The Support Phoenix is actually ridiculous, how much damage it's able to output, the amount of teamfight impact it has. It actually plays so much differently than the offlane Phoenix that... Once upon a time a thing, but is most definitely not anymore.
Is it just primarily only picked with Void, or are people picking it independent of that fact?
It's picked up independent of the fact.
Okay.
It's the Sunray that is really so powerful.
Yeah, they feel like they max Sunray now.
114.
Yeah. Or sometimes 1-2-2, because the Fire Spirits goes from 10 damage a second to 30 damage a second, so it's a really valuable level 2.
It's an interesting way of trying to deal with Chen, because what you usually look for in lineups when the enemy picks Chen is a way of dealing so much damage to the creeps that either you can force out Hand of God or you can just flat out kill them off in the fight and stop the push. And Sunray being percentage based damage, if you get to channel a full Sunray on the Chen creep hitting the tower, he has to pull them back. It's just too much. So the same reason they're banning Gyro. It's not a hero eHome have actually, I think, picked a single time this tournament, but it's just one of the carries that's really good against Chen because it has so much AoE damage.
And we have seen that Weeha still prefers to go for a bit more of the Xor build on Invoker.
Yeah.
Quaswex Invoker is much stronger against Phoenix than Xor Invoker, which does leave a bit of a weakness there because Phoenix is best picked up when the enemy team doesn't have very good disables as well. Like, if you don't have any good heroes, like natural heroes like Juggernaut to be able to dress the egg, and you don't have really strong disables, Phoenix becomes all the more powerful because of that.
Say earlier today, didn't we see eHome get Faceless Void Phoenix, and then they did set phase ban Silencer. They say very good against both of them. I don't know if Secret went to play Silencer or if they would recognize that it could be good here. It does get banned. They decide to go with the Broodmother ban instead.
The second game they played against CDC today, they had a Void Phoenix and then Tusk Warlock.
I think if Secret picks Silencer and they put it on support, they are. To me, Chen Silencer is just a kind of weak support deal, right? Doesn't really. They don't complement each other very well. So then they would have to put it on core, but seeing that they already have Invoker, and I believe Weeha is their Silencer player, and then that would put Envy onto Invoker, which he does play, but it's a very different style if you play Invoker safe lane. So I don't think it's something the Secret are going to look for in this game.
What does banning out the Ember and the Brood say to you? What, in terms of what EOM is going to go for the next two picks? Is it going to be more teamfight orientated?
I think you ban Ember against Envy every single second phase.
Yeah,
okay. I think that's just targeted
phase.
Ban. And then the Brood...
Kind of the same thing, right?
With.
I mean, Brood is just a chalk ban. It's so often seen as like third or even last ban sometimes, depending on if you have a particularly weak support duo who don't have wave clear or your safe laner can't deal with it. Like, it's just you need to get rid of it.
I also think Chen Brood is actually a very good pairing. They both to push and pressure early, and Brood draws so much attention to itself in the lane that Chen gets a free jungle. So they just want to not have to deal with that. They've already moved Prophet and Tide. Now removing that third offlane harasser and having the Void themselves, they might be able to set up a dual lane safe lane that can win, giving Phoenix the room to gank mid, for example.
Earlier today we saw Bounty Hunter being picked for EHOME.
Oh yeah, didn't ban that actually.
And that is still cool indeed. He ended up winning that series too. That was CD. My bad. Wrong team.
But it's still an interesting...
But it's still an interesting
I was considering
thing, yeah.
that in the first phase that Yon was saying. This looks very solid first.
Yeah.
The way I see it now, EHOME, very clear what Secret want to do. They want to have solid lanes, transition into Chen getting mech, and then push towers. So either if you're EHOME, you try to split push, and or just have good push yourselves that can do it. Or you try to have a good team fight that you can actually address when Secret come in. So far, so good for that strategy. Maybe they'll get more of it 10 seconds in their next pick. I think Puck isn't half bad here. I think it's overall a fairly solid choice. But they,
yeah, I think you just need to make sure you have really good
Lina
follow-up damage.
Sure.
Yeah, Lina's good as well.
Zeus we haven't seen yet.
Nope.
It's really good
he's
against
been banned,
Chen.
Though.
He is
he's
very good against Chen.
One of the downsides, I like Puck in certain instances here, because I feel like it's really good against any kind of saving heroes, Ventral Spirit, Dazzle. Like, the AoE control offered is really good as well with Phoenix, but I think that, in a way, Puck and Faceless Void operate in a similar fashion. And I think there's almost, like, too much overlap of AoE disabled.
It worked very well in the game CDC played earlier today against that was Secret.
Yeah,
that
was Secret. They actually crushed that game.
But that was... They made it look easy, and what they did was actually very hard. They
and I would even say that against the Puck, Chris Draft was better against it because they had multiple heroes with saves, whereas now they only have the bench. They had Dazzle and they had something, some other hero
Tusk.
As well. OD, I think it was, wasn't it?
And Tusk.
Yeah. So they had a lot of saves.
Well, if you want more incentive for a Puck, I think that a Sven pickup actually has a lot of good synergy with Puck. One of those carries that's being seen just a lot right now. It's really stable. It's like actually replacing the Juggernaut when it comes to popularity.
Wonder why they grabbed it now, if they think Secret were going to go for it.
I mean, it's pretty feasible, right? If you already have a Chen, you have some pretty strong pushing power. Sven is one of those carries that facilitates and benefits from pushing power, both because he offers you like Warcry and everything else, good physical damage, but also the fact that the pushing... It opens up space for you to be able to deal with Ancients and such.
Is it for Team Secret a Slaughter here viable at all? I mean, you got the double aura / double minus armor from Vengeful Spirit and Slaughter. Is it done enough incentive?
I just think the hero is weak in
offlane.
That's the problem.
It's... I think Beastmaster is more likely than
for
Slaughter.
Nice, Andy.
Well played.
Also,
well
synergize
played.
Is nice with the auras.
What? Did you just well played yourself?
Yeah, dude. You know, well played, Spam. That just makes sense. I mean, if you think about it, back when Void was prevalent, even before the changes, any time there's a lot of melee-centric heroes in the pool, Beastmaster becomes it again. You know, you just get long BKB lockdown, and you just try to kill the hero before he can do anything.
I'm really glad they went back for this Enchantress. It's such a good pickup here.
Yep.
The dual lane, Faceless Void Enchantress, we already talked about how good it is versus Ben, but then if you look at Team Secret lineup in the 3-4 area as well, they still are lacking nuking power. Right, the Beastmaster is okay, but he's more focused on his like Necronomicon and everything else. The Vengeful Spirit is actually more right-click heavy than most other supports, right? So the Enchantress actually has the potential to be a power pick here.
It was also something that CDC were doing every game. They would pick Void and then they would give Q Enchantress because there's, even with BKB, if you get speared against Ench now, you just still get wrecked. Mm-hmm. Like, there's nothing you can really do about
it. Here comes the Luna ban.
Drow is still on the pool.
Drow is in two, actually. It's I think Secret are going to go for one of those two and then just really try to play that game 100%. If they want, they can go back for something more hard carry for Envy and look for the Spectre that they played, for example. I just don't think it's particularly good in this game.
Has Team Secret ever played Ursa?
That
would have been such a strong pickup against Phoenix, Enchantress, it challenges Sven.
Yeah, that would have been great too.
Which heroes do you want to see for Envy now?
Oh, what I want to see?
I like that Drow.
Do I want to see him play? I want to see him play Meepo.
The Meepo. Let's not have that.
But Terrorblade is a good suggestion, actually. That's also very good.
I think Ench kind of destroys Terrorblade, though.
Yeah, and
they ban Zeus.
The cleave, the AoE disable of Faceless Void is pretty rough for Terrorblade. Just the team fight combination that they have doesn't offer many opportunities.
Okay.
And this is probably one of the best heroes you can have against Faceless Void carry wise. This is why so many teams are going to leave their carry to last pick. You would have both counter the enemy carry, but also their offlaner because of how important the offlane position is right now.
They actually have nothing to stop Morph. They can't prevent him from casting it. You can cast it even in Chrono.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a really, really good pickup here for Secret. And actually surprised that it took so long before we saw Morphling pick. I'm saying at the end of day one, but
yeah,
I thought
I
it was going to be a really
big pick. Actually.
Yeah.
Couch one.
We already forgot about it.
Couch two. I want you to think about who you're going to be favoring this this first game. Now that you know the draft, Couch one, you're up first.
I'm going to go with Secret.
You have to discuss with your
team. Oh, I have to discuss with you.
I was actually going to say the same thing.
Okay.
Coming into this saying Ehome was favorite, but I really like the draft from Secret.
I enjoy the Morphling pick.
Couch 2.
You're reading my mind right now. Tell Cheaper what we're thinking.
10 seconds remaining.
Whatever Cinderin says is going to be right.
This is true.
Secret!
Okay, well, it's the... both couches are unanimous on seeing Team Secret take this first game. We're going to find out if that is actually true. It is time for the first game of Secret versus Ehome with Winter and OD Pixel.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, indeed, here we go, the final series of the day here, day one of the group stage of the Shanghai Major, Ehome going up against myself, OD Pixel, and this time, joined by the lovely Winter. Winter, I have had the delight of casting Secret already today early against CDC, this time, going up against Ehome, we've seen the drafts, we're getting the Jackie Mao Morphling, is this the game for the Waveform Boy?
Yeah, I think Morphling was a great pick here, like, even the panel mentioned. He has some sort of burst to deal with the Enchantress, very good versus Chronosphere, you can morph to Strength, and if you look at their lockdown, they don't really have very good reliable lockdown, like Chronosphere is a very long cooldown, so basically the most reliable lockdown they have is the Stormhammer, which can be solved by getting a Lincoln Sphere, which is something generally Morphing would get. So I think Morphing can have a really, really good performance in this sort of lineup.
Let's see. The battle begins. Top rune, it looks like it's not going to be contested, and wow, neither of them are going to be, so Ehome are going to be able to grab themselves both of the bounties there.
Wow.
Secret just not looking to put up a fight at E-Rends of the map for that one.
That was such a huge blow. And Enchantress, is gonna, because of that, can play actually really aggressive. I think they are probably going to help up the Void. That's the first and foremost thing that Lam is going to accomplish right now, and Paladai might... Is he looking to do a body block here? He doesn't have any more sentries, so he can't really block off his camp near the ancients.
I mean, Pilotai is taking a fair bit of harassment here from Lanham. He's gonna chase this one down pipe. That's got a magic missile, in case Lanham gets a little bit too hasty, but nonetheless. A 1v1 there between the two of them, and Pilotai taking the brunt of it, he has to back himself off. But lane-wise, do you see any side coming out on top? You've always talked already about how the Morphling should be able to do okay. Down on the bottom lane, CTY, Sven, he has got to put up with Misery on the Beastmaster, and that's going to be a little bit annoying for this melee core.
Yeah, both teams have been like quite greedy. They have jungling heroes, and they have support that scale really well with levels, especially on Ehome. The Phoenix doesn't really do really well at throwing off the offlane, so they're going to have, like, both teams, the offlaners will be having a lot of levels at 11, taking a stun from Paladin here, but he's gonna time block off all the damage, but as of now he's getting a lot of experience, and we'll see when Lam is actually gonna decide that he's gonna come in with a creep and gonna help out the lane. And he might want to wait for Chen to make his move first, because like these two heroes, the Chen versus the Enchanter,
yeah,
they might like, the Enchanter probably wants to go wherever the Chen goes, because you can actually stronger at the Chen at this stage, because you can have more creeps than the Chen. Chen can only get one creep as of now.
It's going to be very interesting to see how this Chen versus Chantress does end up going on. And talking about matchups, the mid lane, Old Chicken on his leaner against Weehar's Invoker. 8 for 3 against 7 for 2, so fairly close between these two here. And I mean, do you expect to see either side break away? Or a certain side going to look to prioritize the gank on the mid lane first?
I think both sides can actually get a gank off. Like, if the Chen comes mid, Invoker can help with obviously the cold snap. And it might be a little bit more difficult for the Enchantress, because Lina can't, it's difficult for Lina to set up to the cold snap. And obviously still do it, but it's not as easy. But I think it's still possible for both sides. Like, the Chen and Enchantress are going to be playing a really crucial role in both of the team's success early game. Whoever makes the better moves will be able to control the early game. So, see Lam running into the enemy's jungle right now. He's trying to look for a puppy. He has a tornado creep, so he might want to just grab the creep.
And well, in the mid lane, we are just getting straight outplayed by Old Chicken. And well, we talked about potential gank wasn't needed in the end. And top lane as well, 11 trying to go on to Envy, who will be able to turn around here with the south. Pilot die with the body blocks as well off the back of a magic missile. And it looks like Old Lam could be in trouble. The Sunray is there healing him. Lam is at his back, but it doesn't matter. Envy goes forward with the waveform, and they will find the kill onto the void. Bit of a mess up in the mid lane, losing that 1v1 there as Weehar goes down, but Secret able to find something in return on the top lane.
Oh, top lane as well, Paladai gonna come in. They might actually get the surround onto Lam here, and they do have the Sunstrike available in 4 seconds for this kill.
And Lanham still need to be very, very careful. Deep high, he's got the mana back up for that magic missile. Lanham jumping around the tree line, pings are out onto Envy, but Envy is out of mana. He's already got a lot that he can contribute to this. But Lanham's gonna be alright. Pylar died, just unable to get the wraparound and trapping him in the jungle.
Yeah. And he might actually want to consider getting a bottle here, just so that he can actually keep himself in the lane. Otherwise, Void will be, even though he died, but because he forced the enemy to expend so much resources, so much mana, so much HP, that even though he died, he's gonna be able to get a lot after that. The enemy doesn't have any potential killing him because of the lack of mana. If the Phoenix up here, Envy, can they actually get the kill?
Yeah, they're looking to drive down N11, jumping in. Can he find Envy? Yes, he can. Gets the final touch there on the Morphling. While I die on the bench, can see if he can find anything off the bat, but he needs to be careful himself. Lanham's coming in. Force Pile I die to hug his tower.
And damage from the Sunray.
And you can see why he haven't been picking this here as much as they have. They're still on the
and then Pile I die.
He's gonna get dived upon by the three of them. Fairy Fire's gonna get popped, but the bench is gonna go down. Envy coming in will find the kill onto the Phoenix. So something in return there for Secret. But a lot of aggression being applied by Ehome on the side of Secret on the top lane.
You can see here Chen hasn't really accomplished much yet. He's going back to base because he doesn't have mana anymore, but Enchanter so far being much more active in terms of participating in helping his team's laning phase. And Morphling, despite getting 2 kills here, but he doesn't really have great amount of CS, but he does still have 2 kills, so he went for the ring, so definitely going for the Lincoln Sphere build up here. Really good this game, like I mentioned. And looking at CTY.
Talking about the farm, CTY. He's top of the board, 36 last hits at the moment. I mean, this the Beastmaster Misery, he's himself 18 for 4.
Pretty good for Misery. Despite the Sven having to farm. But if you look at the middle lane, Lina is also crushing the Invoker really, really badly in terms of net worth.
Yeah, off the back of that kill, Old Chicken's really gone ahead, and Weehar knows he's got to be careful. There's level 6, soon to be level 7 ready. And he also, of course, has this aura here.
Sure. He's going to be making the first move right now to help his team.
A CTY, this would be the big kill if they can find it. And they've got a Primal Rod set it up. It's backed up from Eho. Sunstrike coming through as well. They're looking to burst down as well. The Sunray healing and backup isn't quite enough, so they will lose the spend on the side of Eho. Secret, they're going to try for more. We're chasing down Kaka, chasing down Lanham. They're looking for the Enchantress. Has got a couple of points in Untouchable. Three of them continuing to chase. There's your Magic Missile back up. They'll get the stun out onto Lanham. The damage is going to be enough. They'll find themselves a second kill. Puppy. Been given a lot of kind of hate in the jungle there by Lanham's Enchantress, but now coming into the lane and still proving that he can find those ganks with the successful smokes and 2 kills that are going to be very valuable to Secret at this point of the game.
Oh, top lane, NVA just used his replica, TP back to base, but he didn't really actually get full mana, so he's back, but Void, because he doesn't have full mana, Void is still, like, terrifying.
Misery, maybe hang around a little bit too long, CT1 will find the Stormhammer, and this Sunrise, this Kaka just comes in, takes down the Beastmaster, Pi is coming back, and he's got a magic missile, Pi like, guy can't get it, bam! Yes, he can, Venge with the pick. Goes in the way of Beastmaster there, thanks to the boar.
They still had Sunstrike anyway, so Phoenix was just dead there. But it was still a good kill for them, a great support for offlane. But right now, just look at Envy, he's not having a good time at all because of the fact that he was left alone by his team, and Void is extremely good at 1 versus 1.
Void's got a Chrono as well. I mean, Envy has got to be careful, he's still got a bit of mana pool to play with.
Yeah, waveform. So, let's see. Can he actually get out of this? But he seems like most likely going to
go down. Now he's morphed too much, so he's committing here for the full strength. Misery is there to back him up, and they'll just actually go straight for the Chrono here. Old Leather moving forward, and the Strength Morph still keeping Envy alive. Purple Balls of the Satyr Tormentor, not enough to bring him down, and now Pylite Dire has come up to the top lane, looking to turn the aggression around, kicking out Old 11 with the Roar as well, the Sunstrike, they'll be able to punish Void's aggression. But also pick up the Satyr Tormentor as well, so nice reaction there from Secret, keeping Envy safe. He will have to make that long walk back to the base, but not losing his life this time.
Yeah, that was actually just really good play by Envy there. He was actually baiting the Void so hard. I thought the Void would have enough to actually get the kill, but Envy played the situation right. He still had some magic stick charges and baited the Void into a really bad position, so his team could actually have time to back up him and return kill there. Really good play from him. And looking at the Invoker, he sort of caught back up a little bit, but he's still really far behind from the Lina. Lina right now, he's going for the first item, Aetherlands. I think we saw this one time today. I can't remember from who, but we were discussing at the panel whether it's actually better to get Aetherlands first or the Yield better. So regardless of the sequence, most of the time you would get both of the items.
Yeah, I mean, do you feel there's any reason why this game Old Chicken Dad does decide to go for the Aetherlands first?
I mean, it's still a really good farming tool, and it actually helps you, you know, you have a little bit more damage in terms of your whole tree spell output early, and you have set up from your team, from the Sven and from the Faceless Void, so maybe he feels like he doesn't really need the Yule setup that badly, and they're gonna rotate down to bottom, they might find Envy once more here.
Well, they smoked up for this one. Smoke is gonna get dispelled on the Old Chicken's Lina, and Envy will be able to walk that one off, so it looks like they won't find anything with the smoke either. None of the rest are secret really around that bottom lane, you can see them elsewhere. Old 11 getting a bit more space here on the Void on the top.
Yeah, but this is looking really bad for the Morphling, because as of now, Morphling is already behind. If you combine to the Sven.
Swap onto Lina, Old Chicken being dragged into the river. Nice play really from Pylite Dai.
Really good play by Pylite Dai, but going back to the point where I was mentioning about the Morphling. Morphling is going to fall behind again in the next few minutes because Sven has the ability to do Ancients and he's starting to stack up. So that's going to be the point of the game where Morphling will fall really far behind compared to the Sven. So this is looking really worrisome for Envy because he doesn't really have the best early game right now for the Morphling. And Ehome looking to get their team fight online, coming online with the Phoenix hitting a lane so that he can actually obtain his level 6. So even though giving up a kill on the Lina, things still looking really good for Ehome as of right now. Sven is doing really well, Lina is doing really well, and the supports are getting the levels that they need.
Final dice, nothing else, anything here. Yeah, let's get the magic missile on top of Chicken. Was able to bottle up that ring first, and now the swap turns around and kind of secret is there, and there again, your swap from Pylite Dai. Second swap, the last is getting here. Someone coming out just to cover the Chrono is now out to 2. They're looking to take down Wee there, now they're going to look for a second one. Old Lemon Kaka chasing down the Chen, they'll find the kill. 2-for-1 there. The Ehome, even though they do lose their mid, they're able to find Weeha in the third turn, and they get Puppy as well to boost, so
yeah,
they'll be happy with that.
It was really crucial, Owen, because right now Kaka has his level 6, so Ehome feel really, really confident in terms of, even though despite using the Chronosphere for that kill, but right now they have another tool in their arsenal, which is the Supernova, so they're feeling confident that they can actually push and get this tier 1 tower in the middle lane, which would give them a lot of map control right now. So Ehome looking really strong after that trade, and Squid needs to, you know, and give space to the Morphling to farm and catch up as well. Level 1 Necrobook on Misery. Still a decent timing considering his team situation. it's really good at kiting. Like his ball and the Necrobook are really good at kiting in terms of later into the game. They have the swap as well, so they have really good tools that are limiting how much CTY can do in teamfights. So even though CTY is really farm, they have a lot of and the raw as well, so they have a lot of tools that slowing him down and cutting him and making sure that he doesn't deal damage. And another swap on
the jungle again. Pilot guys, look at this swap off. They'll follow it through with a roar. He's got the Warcry though. CTY fairly tanky on this bet. I've got the boar slow, but backup's gonna come in. Lanham is there, and yeah, just the two of them alone didn't quite have enough damage. We saw VR coming in, but a little bit too late, not quite close enough to do too much. And yeah, the CTY is gonna be an issue.
That Warcry, man, that armor. Is definitely going to be an issue, but at the same time, like I mentioned, they do have the tools to him. They have the draw, they have the swap, they have the form, the Beastmaster, Necrobook, so we'll see.
Oh, mid lane. Ringo kind of getting baited, born, an old chicken straight up with the Light Strike. They'll be able to find this one. And dilation from Old Lever, making sure that we are can't bring out any of his tricks.
And we are definitely having a really, really rough time. From the laning phase transitioning into the mid game, he's just not catching a break right now, and power finally goes down, so Yeon will have further control of the jungle, and Lam is going to look to place a ward in enemy territory soon, so he's going to have one ward here to scout out whether the invoker is jungling, and hopefully with that ward, they'll be able to consolidate on their advantage more by getting further kills. Vlad is also completed on the void, so there are 5 men right now with the ultimates, with the supernova and with the chrono is really, really strong. And not to mention Enchantress, you know. Enchantress still deals a lot of damage despite having too much items. Chronosphere. So all their heroes deal damage with the Chronosphere. You have the Sunray, you have the Impetus, you have obviously the Lina nukes, and you know the Sven Stun. Teamfight wise, I think Ehome are looking really good right now when they have all their ultimates up.
The old 11 Desperate's very fine. To jump in, but it's in fact going to be Secret spotting him out there with the Horde. They're going to move forward, they're going to swap again. Pilot died with the control, and they've got the stun lock there with the cold snap, the magic missile.
What a spell.
Where's your time walk now? Where's your time walk now, son?
At sad times, you know, for heroes like Void, Earthshaker, not much you can do about that. You get caught, and right now, Secret with the big kill, they might actually transition into a Roshan here. Yes, they will. They have really good heroes like Sam Yavos and the bench, the Beastmaster, so this is a really good move because they are maximizing the advantage they can get from that one of the Void. So
Without Void, I'm going to get the
chance to
see if that's taken down.
So Weeha gets the Aegis. How much progress MD has made? Yes. 1200 gold, Perseverance, main. Fine, but right now he still has a long way to go before he truly comes online after mounting him.
But, I mean, as you said in the drop, when he does eventually come online,
he's really good.
It's
going to
be a good game
for Morphin. Yeah. I mean, you can go for Aquabed, I think, after the Lincoln's game. Aquabed is really good versus the Chronosphere, and it's very good for. Of the heroes, like the species heroes like the Lina, the Enchanters, but all the good options that he has, the Ethereal Blade, or even going for, if he wants to go for more like farming speed, he can go for the Manta, but those are options that he will be having in his mind to decide what he should do this game, depending on the game. So, but Ehome hasn't really.
They jump straight onto the Weehawk. There's a wraparound from Secret. Can Secret find anything in return? They've got the Aegis, of course, on the Invoker, the Roar onto Kafka. No chance for a Supernova. That's going to be the first casualty here for the side of Ehome now. Can Secret find more Light Strike? Holding back Tylai Dai. Looks like the rest of Ehome will be able to scatter. But a bit of a bait there. Weehawk using the Aegis to draw Ehome in, and the rest of Secret ready with a wraparound that time. They'll get the kill, and they'll give themselves the power here as well.
Yeah, and without one of their big ultimates and Phoenix down, they can't really defend. I wonder if they try to defend when Phoenix is alive in 5 seconds, but the tower is taking huge amounts of damage if they do so much with the Beastmaster aura, the Bench aura.
Push is real here. I mean, we saw how quickly Secret could take down Roche. They're showing the same power here against this tier 2, already about to pull Kaka. Coming in with the swoop. There's your Ray as well. Find the initiation to get the storm out onto Weehawk with the Light Strike as well and focus down. The Skarsgård's the Supernova, Secret gonna get themselves out, probably with the TP out, but it's not gonna be able to do it. The damage from CTY too much, it's a double kill, three of them now dead on the side of Secret. Misery being slowed by the time dilation, he will be able to get himself out of there. Maybe sticking around a little bit too long though, won't he?
Yeah, they were a little bit too confident. They were probably thinking that, oh, Chrono's down, but they still have Supernova. But they might be just overestimating a little bit their abilities, that they still could have taken the fight. They felt they could have fought even though Supernova was still up, but they were wrong. So they overextended, they paid their lives. But the next thing I'm thinking about, whether Weeha is also deciding to go for Necrobook with their lineup, because I'm thinking they can actually hit the timing. Like, I don't even see Necrobook too often on this anymore nowadays, but with their lineup, the Necrobook can actually do a lot.
Oh, Misery. Oh, this is a lovely room for Old Chicken to have. Easy setup there for the boys, straight with the Laguna. He's a tanky man, Misery, not quite tanky enough. We'll get the Necrobooks out, and he will start to chip back away at them, but getting there with the Summary. And we'll be fine, and they'll get themselves that kill, and there's times like that where having an invis rune is certainly feels very lucky.
Yep, and with the raw down, it also means that the other heroes have much more space and, you know, have much more room to actually farm. And UI complete just a moment ago, and now he has another 1500 gold. I think typically the way he builds his heroes, sometimes he gets a very early Moonshot on his Juggernaut, Sven, and even his Anti-Mage. I'm not sure if you pay attention on how the way he builds his carries.
He does some inventive stuff.
Yeah, he does very different stuff compared to other players. So I'm interested to see what route he actually goes for this game. Phoenix is going for Midas, so he just got it. So it's a typical item for a hero that relies on levels a lot, because you want to get to that level 16 as soon as possible. And for the Enchantress, he's going for, it seems like a pipe. Pretty interesting. Usually we see Dragonlance, we see Drum, we see Treads, anything that improves your HP so that you can actually use the Untouchable and, you know, the Nature's Attendance to full effect. So I think I haven't really seen pipe from Enchantress for a long time. That'll be interesting as
yeah, that's your item pick up for CTY. We'll be going for the Blink Dagger this game, so not something too out of the ordinary hit for the old Sven. They're pretty much the classic. But I guess one thing, yeah, if the pipe does end up getting fully online for the inch, it does mean, of course, that CTY can afford to go more aggressive with
him,
not worrying too much
about it. Get the place earlier. Oh.
This could be big. We can't see him straight. Oh!
No! That was so close.
So close.
Must be a down, so sick. I think they actually saw that, I'm not sure. So I wonder if they're actually gonna just make use of this timing window again. One big shot out.
CTY, he wants to go for this. He's alright, let's go. Let's go and find initiation. He's actually piloted over the swap, but CTY will be able to get the blink after the swap. Getting damage to cancel the further Stormhammer. Gonna only stun. Here, Puppy will get caught out by the Sunway. They'll find themselves one kill. He hoping they find themselves anything more. They've got the slow on to Misery. Oh, 11 time walking forward. There's your bash. Now CTY coming in with the right clicks, and we've got a pause.
Right.
it would be Envy.
Not the best timing, but it's
Envy.
Envy as usual, you know, having issues.
My sound. Not your sound. My sound.
Oh well.
Oh well.
But it doesn't really change Misery's fate.
Misery might survive here.
Give him a 1% chance of
I'm going. Taking bets on that.
1% chance, Odie.
1%? That's generous. Now the question is, who's going to get the kill?
Let's look at the projectile.
He's thrown out Stormhammer in his CTY, yeah. I think I believe this Griff is right here. And yeah, looks like the odds are CTY. CTY for the kill.
I think 11 might actually get the last video.
Oh no, okay! Oh, it was Lanham. We were both wrong. Oh, two castings comes.
Give the man that's building a team item the kill, you know, he needs to go.
Oh, we should have known. He's because of the build, it's just a level 1 Stormhammer. It practically heals the enemy. Nonetheless,
still better than Homing Missile, level 1.
But Secret, losing 2 there. Not the fight that they were looking for down there on the bottom lane.
There was really good play by CTY though. He once again baited the enemy. He TP'd in front and the bench stopped him, but he couldn't. I think he probably should have tried to use his power first to disable the blink and then stop him. And then you have a better chance of landing a stun on the target. But because he swapped immediately, he just blinked right away, and he was in a really bad position after that. So a bit of misplay from Bench and a little bit reaction from CY.
Yeah, and he's got to be a bit careful here. And that was Envy. Let me guess, is it sound?
Well.
Well.
Might be something else this time.
It could be.
For CTY, having this juicy amount of ancient stack again, you know? That's like the difference between the morphling and...
Yeah, the farm speed here.
But when you look at how... I don't know if you actually paid attention to recent games where CTY, when he played morphling... He actually did the Helm of Dominator build, so he could actually jungle and do ancients, morphling. Do you actually see the games that he actually did that? I think it was quite thing because of the fact that you are actually able to jungle early, so your support's in the lane, and you're able to do ancients with that build. With the Lincoln's build, you're basically only able to put lanes and to a certain extent jungle, but not as quick as the Helm of Dominator build. Obviously, Lincoln's is in most games a really good item for morphing.
Yeah, that's the classic.
But you know, it's just something interesting to know that CTY does that. So that he can actually jungle and give room to the support to actually take the lane.
I apologize for this pause. Of course, quite sure what it's about at the moment. MV hasn't given us any intel. Sure, I'm sure everything's going to be fine. Calm. Enjoy the final series of the day. It's going to be good. It's been good so far, 13 to 10.
It's not really good for the Invoker though, this game. He's been having a really rough time.
He's had a bit of an up and down day. He's played Invoker a few times. We've seen some absolutely amazing performances on his Invoker. He really can shine on this hero.
He still hasn't decided what he wants to go though. He went for the Boots of Travel, which might mean that he's unsure that what route that he wants to go for.
I mean, if they can hold it off, take it late, get that Morphling kind of stacked up, so do you think they're going to be more comfortable than Secret? I mean, obviously with the heroes, you know, they were going to want to go for that push. Can they now transition into something that's going to be decent against a late game hard-hitting Sven?
I think they can though, because like I mentioned, they have good tools at dealing with a very farm Sven and the Beastmaster Roar, and obviously in Invoker late game saw how scary the hero can be in a lot of games in the recent months. Of the Aghanim's and the way you build the hero, Aghanim's Occurring Call, you're really strong late game with your spells. So I could see either team actually winning the game. The game goes into late game because both sides, I feel, have really strong late game. Ehome's team fight might still be stronger, but Secret has tools to deal with, like I mentioned, the Sven. They have tools to deal with the Chronosphere as well.
So at the moment, the action going down in the players' room. Team Secret, minus Envy. I'm sure he's just to the right of us, off the screen, hiding there. Can assure you, he is indeed in the room, and Pylidai is not microing both of the accounts. He might be. Actually, talking about Pylidai, he's having a good game so far. Some of these swaps, I mean, he's been the reason why they're finding the kills. I think there was that one swap in the river that kind of resulted in a bad trade for Secret, and that one actually down the bottom. So he's got to be careful. That's the thing though with the Venge. But it's nice to see a Venge being played very offensively. A lot of the times we see the Venge being the one sitting at the back, ready to save someone. This Venge from Pylidai is very much I'm the one initiating it, I'm the one starting the fight off.
Yeah, it's really good that he's actually doing that a lot to help his team secure kills. And, you know, generally the hero, I understand that certain teams would be really passive with it, but can also be used very aggressively, and we see Secret doing it with a lot of success. Yeah, but going back to the Invoker item build this game, I know I mentioned the possibility of Necrobook being really good this game, but if you're looking you just mentioned if Seward are considering going just all out into the late game, then going for the Aghanim's would be best choice if you're looking to get to the late game as soon as possible with a good items on Invoker. You want a mobility item, maybe Link, and then with Aghanim's. Pair it with Aghanim's. Probably would be also a good idea for Viha this game. Depending on what his team wants to do in the next next 10 minutes especially. Whether they want to choose to fight, or they want to choose to just, you know, chill, farm, wait for Roshan, and just play for the late game.
I mean, talking about this Ench's build, the fact that obviously with the Hood maybe going for that, do you think, you know, Lanham is going to finish off the pipe, or are we going to see the Dragonlance, the Aghanim's come out now? Is it just the Hood to help himself against the Burst of Secret, rather than going for the full-out pipe? first time.
I actually think he might actually want to go for the pipe though.
Okay.
Just his team, because it just doesn't really make sense if he doesn't complete it. I understand certain heroes actually do it, like maybe you're against a high magic lineup, but usually you do it on the core. I'm not sure if you do it on the support. I think you want to finish the pipe to help your team. So I think that that's better that he completes the pipe.
Been having a good game so far, Lanham, as we can see.
Yeah, he's been really, really aggressive, like in terms of the laning phase. Like the reason the Void and the Lina are doing so well because he's been exerting pressure on the enemy safe lane, and the enemy jungler that Secret needs to expend so much resources to tracking him down early. And the first move by Secret came really late to the bottom lane. That was their first smoke play after Lam had actually done so much in the safe lane of Secret. Lam has been, you know, the unsung hero for this team. Like in the past few games as well, his Lion has been played really well, and this in the Ench.
And it looks like we are going to have a bit of a pause, so we should be able to get a recap on the last fight here, Winter. And indeed, this is the one where Pilot does make the swap, but does result in a bad fight here for Secret.
Yeah, they couldn't actually burst him fast enough, and 11 managed to come in with the Chronosphere, and this fight gave Kaka his level 6 as well. So they were able to proceed to get the power after this, I believe. Not mistaken, they got the tier 1 as well. And 11 here with the cold snap, the swap into cold snap, he can't really time walk out.
They got
the Phoenix first. That was the really, really big thing here. Phoenix got busted down, so that was a huge part of their team fight down the drain. So immediately after expanding the Chrono, they have no way of fighting Secret here. But Secret pushed, they overextended.
But then they hung around too long because Kaka now does come in and
they thought they could have taken a fight because Chronosphere was down, but they were still unable to fight because the Supernova was just still really hard to deal with.
And CTY at that point just turns up and he's got the damage with the God Strength. And again, this is pretty much the same on this bottom lane. You know, Secret were trying to go for a push, hang around a little bit too long. Puppy getting caught out there by the Troll Trap. And I believe they do find, Misery as well. Ah, yeah, that's when we had the famous My Sound paused. Pauses.
Yeah, and hopefully we guess what the enemy
going
said.
Soon. Let's try.
Kaka said we don't understand.
That's what he told her last night. Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Back on with the game. Ehome versus Secret. Is 13 to 10 at the moment, and CTY, as we talked about, cleaning up that juicy ancient stuff, and this man's going to be a rich man.
And enemy is going to be a jealous man because he can't really do that, has his morphing this game, which is now proven to be the difference in the net worth. Sven is still ahead by, I mean, enemy actually cut it down by a good margin. Before that it was probably around 3,000, the difference, but right now it's 2k gold, so definitely catching up pretty well compared to the Sven here. So let's see what Sven goes for as well after his dagger. He's going to go for a BK or he's just going to go for more like damage.
I think I'd like to see him go for either the AC or all the moonshots.
AC is
CTY
nice.
Stuff.
AC is really nice with the physical damage from Ward Spirit, you know, the Necrobook as well.
Yeah,
and the morphing right click.
It's going to be great against this.
So that's definitely a good option for CTY here. And looking at the other heroes, Phoenix so far still hasn't gotten anything else and chances seeing whether he comes. Pipe, Old Chicken has Skills and Aether Lens, spread their partner hero. So most likely next item you consider on Lina is either the BKB or you want to get Talents right away. He might want to get BKB so that he doesn't get busted down so easily.
Okay.
So that would be a good consideration for the Lina. Sometimes when you go for Aghanim's and you don't have BKB, you can't really use your spells really well in team fights because you get focused down easily.
Yeah, I mean, as we saw from that one in the river where he got swapped from Pilot Day, he did get the spells up, but only just.
He actually completed the hood 3 times and pipe 0 times.
Okay, so just the hood here for Lanham.
Interesting.
Yeah. She's changing it up.
The reasoning is just so that he can actually survive the magic burst from Invoker, I guess. Don't want to get one-shotted even because like morphing might go for Atterbrake. So
it is going to be nice against EE because as we were saying earlier, Ench being one of the heroes that Morph would have liked to easily burst down and having that hood at this point at least is going
to
make it hard.
Interesting to see that the way he thinks,
yeah.
The game.
some smart cookies here on the side of Ego. Now, they look to maybe find here. Warcry's pop, they look to find this tier 1 secret from the complementary fortification. We'll see if Pilot Die wants to go for one of his in. Crazy initiation short. Yes, they do. Grounds the CTY. Raw as well, but the Sunray is hitting him back up. Oh no, coming out from the left. He's only going to catch Puppy here on the sideline. Just to keep CTY alive for timing. He's trying to move himself out of here, but nah, the damage is too much. Secret will find the kill on Sven, and that is Sven on the map for 60 seconds. And this can be held back by Light Strike Array. They're trying to move forward for more here. Strike straight onto the void. Kakko's going to look for the TP here, but he's not going to make it. Bursted down. Pylite die. Pin that one up with a magic missile. And again, Pi really turning up this game. Yeah. That's what.
You see this time he didn't repeat the same mistake. He got the half to cancel.
He got the wave first.
Yeah, yeah. He cancelled the blink, so CTY couldn't get away. And the Beastmaster Raw was also committed for that kill, and that was a really good initiation from Secret. However, the counter initiation from the Faceless Void there was not anywhere near as good as Secret's initiation. He needed to catch more heroes to actually save the Sven. But because the big cooldown is down right now, Secret are gonna abuse the window of opportunity to actually shoot Hydra right now. And things are not looking good for Eom here. They're gonna take probably a lot of tower damage. They might even lose the tower here, just push really quickly with the heroes. But once again, like, they decided they don't want to make the same mistake they made in the middle lane where they tried to go too far and they lost too many heroes. And the sandbag.
Oh, Puppy! He's saved fine. He won't be able to save himself. Tried for a cheeky TP in the trees. Gonna pay off there as they're well on top of that with the light strike. And CTY talking about his build, it isn't gonna be the AC moon shards, anything funky TY. Keeping it standard this time. Go for the BKB, it's safe.
Many spells that can, you know.
Especially with the Morphling Z-Blade now.
Yeah. It's like, even though you talk about, oh, it still goes, Raw still goes through BKB, Swap still goes through BKB, but it's also like the fact that Magic Missile, that's Cold Snap, that's the Meteor.
And that's an Invoker.
That's the, you know, even the Chen, you know, it's really annoying. Like, how it's been. I saw him holding on into the Purge Creep, the Status, last fight. It's got a really significant buff recently to the cooldown. It had just a 3-second cooldown on the purge, so it's really useful in kiting melee carries like a Sven. So definitely the BKB is gonna help him in that department in teamfight. So he's
very close to
100 gold away from it. So Ehome is gonna wait for that before they.
They might try and fight Bomb though. You got 11 starting to jump in. Oh no. Old 11 overstepped the mark. It was a replica and now he himself will pay.
You got ulti gun?
Oh, you very good. Oh, leader! Save yourself, son. Get yourself out of here. Will do, but Morphling will turn and take the kill onto Phoenix Dead Envy. You can have a second one there for the side of Secret. And I hate to point fingers, but they're still off the back of an unfortunate Chronosphere from the Void there, leading the side of Ehome into that one.
That's Roshan for Secret, and that was also the reveal for the Astral Blade. They did not see the Astral Blade at all, so that was the first time Ehome encountered the Astral Blade from Envy, so they have to be very cautious for this. He can actually burst from the Lina from both, because Lina actually went for... Oh, he's going for the Aghanim, so he's not going for the BKB. So he's going for the much riskier build, but the damage intensive build. So he might be actually at risk that falling to that combination himself from the market. So he needs to be very careful with his positioning. Old chicken. And it seems like Lamb is not gonna finish the pipe. Like Statsman suggested, he's going back for Fred. Casual Foot of Defiance. So this is really interesting to see.
We've now got Botstun on Misery as well, so him and of course Weehars and Voka, who's now less than 1k gold away from that Aghanim, so are going to be able to get themselves across the map and start to pull Ehome apart.
They're looking really good going into the late game, man. The next thing I would probably want to see or like to see from Secret is getting a gem to secure the map, because right now because there are a lot of map control with the Beastmaster Hawk and obviously getting the Roshan, so you want to eliminate the enemy's vision. That would be your next and most important step, so they can't actually leave the base because they're contained. Yeah, when you're losing, you have to rely on your vision to actually know where you can farm. But actually, looking at Ehome's vision, they do not have much vision now. They do not have any observer wards out on the map, it's mostly just sentry. They have observer wards, but they just got removed.
They've got obs on Lanham.
In 1 ward left? It means actually Seeker was able to actually deward. I didn't pay attention to that. Most of the Dome has, despite not having a gem. So I think they did a really good job in that department.
They might have caught some out with the level 3.
Yeah, that was right.
And it's all, he's, you know, he's been able to maintain quite good control of the map, mid lane, old 11. I'm going to want to walk into that one in the middle. Going to back off and Ehome now, being a lot more reserved, sticking themselves right up into their own base. You've got bots now on EE, so his farm is going to continue to accelerate. You can see it already on the network.
Yeah, he's going to
really catching up.
He's going to start to take over the Sven because they have map control, and Sven is very scared of, like, farm. You look at him, he was like, he farmed atop of a couple of waves and he just backed off because they don't have vision. He's really afraid of actually just going out too far. And right now it's gonna hurt him a lot because he went for the BKB. Like, when you go for the BKB, you wanna fight Sven. But as of their position right now, they can't really fight because the enemy has Aegis and they have superior map control. BKB is like essentially a kinda not optimized for hero. You wanna be able to fight when you get a BKB. So that's really unfortunate for him. Just the game, situation of the game became really bad for them after they lost the last fight and giving away the Roshan. Second Roshan is super.
And I really like this Dire Wards as well, it's really nice in the middle, and we saw their Misery just coming in on the bottom and straight away started a secret. They saw Ehome making a movement all the way towards the Beastmaster, giving that space on the top down to just come in with a push backed up by Weehan, take the tier loop. Dire Wards doing quite a lot in this position of the game where Ehome are sticking as a group in their base and moving as a pack between the lanes. You can clearly see where the side of Ehome are.
Basically, it's also not easy for Secret to push high ground now because Ehome has really good high ground defense with a team fight. But they are doing the other option, which is to suffocate the enemy right now. You can't really leave the base if you're at Ehome because you don't have vision. And Secret can just use them they have right now to just out farm and just farm, just pulling a hit on their core heroes, just farming and just making sure that Ehome doesn't leave their base, even despite not getting picked off because Ehome are just constantly hugging each other in the base.
I mean, look at Pilo Dai, we've been talking about his swaps. He's picked the Yoga Club, but now starts to stockpile. Do you think he is going for the Aghanim set?
Yeah, I think Aghanim is a really good item. Like, even if you are on carry bench, I think it's still a really good item on the hero, because it means that when you die, you're still contributing to the team fight. You're doing physical damage, you're using your spells. I think it's a really good item on bench overall. It doesn't really matter your support or a carry position.
I'm talking about it, doesn't go for it. Saved up and bought the straight up Vladimir's. Just pull out.
He changed his mind, I guess.
Yeah, just for the pull out Vlad's.
So that they can actually. They might actually be deciding to hit a timing and to use Aegis in the next few minutes. So the Vladimir's obviously is going to help them push. Maybe that's the plan for them right now. They want to be able to push. And obviously, Puppy has his Ag. So they're going to look to wait for the Ancients to spawn so he can actually get himself one. One of the granite golems, that would be the best creep for them to draw. And with the Vlad, I guess they're looking at a really, really good timing in the next few minutes before the Aegis expires. So that should be Secret's land right now.
Okay, to try and get as much as they can out of Weehan.
Yeah, they don't get a golem here, and that's that. Halada is gonna be the one clearing the Ancients because he can as a support. And I'm not sure if they wanna wait. If you look at what Puppy's creeps composition are right now, he has a Mookie aura, he has the ice armor, he has obviously the dragon aura. So the last one he wants is definitely still the granite aura. More HP. They might still want to wait for it because I think it's going to be a huge difference waiting for that creep.
And are you kind of happier waiting for that, and even if the Aegis expires, you feel they don't really need to force anything at this point?
Yeah, but the best case scenario is
having both.
Before the Aegis expires, you make the Aegis plus all the creeps. Because I think Secret are hitting a really strong timing window right now. And Evoker also has 2k gold he hasn't spent, so curious to see what he wants to go for next. He's gonna go for more spell damage with the offering call, reducing the cooldown, or he wants to go for maybe Shiva's. That he sells both his items still, so he's definitely going for the offering call right now to, you know, further improve his spells and, you know, just about his spells right now in the late game. So Sven hit by, I believe, morphing combo. Already left.
I'm liking this now. It's starting to step at the point where CTY is gonna build the deeps. He's got the Crystallis. 1500, I imagine it will be completing the full out Daedalus before anything else, really.
Yeah, but the point still goes back to Sithios that they can actually deal with the Sven.
They can kind of.
Yeah, Titan, despite him having a huge amount of damage. So I think that despite the Sven getting a lot of damage items, he still has to rely on his team to be able to actually deal damage. He needs to avoid that to hit a good corner.
Oh, fuck, man, Cactus is getting blown up. And that was the gem. That was your Phoenix out all alone with the Gem of True Sight. So Secret are going to be very happy with that one. I guess Cactus didn't think so because he put that Radiant Ward down, but...
Oh yeah, Puppy didn't get
didn't spot it out.
Get. And again, so he's not going to be too happy about that. Sucks for him, but I guess they're still going to push with the timing, are they? No, they're still going to continue farming. He's still in... Look at him, he's pinging the Ancients. He wants to wait for a Granite Golem.
Don't get lucky one day, Pop.
Oh, there's one over here. On the Radiant camp, Ancient camp.
Yeah. Does anyone to make the journey over there?
I mean, they have total map control, so why not?
Yeah, someone's going to end up passing that point. And we'll see if Pyre Wii is check it out for Puffin. Gonna be a DD rune here on the river. Another wave of terrible spotting out, so they know that the Granite Golems are there now.
Secret have been just controlling the game really well. And so they have finally found the Granite Golem. Pyre shot it out. Puffy is gonna move over, so see whether they actually finally make their move right now with this Granite Golem. They have everything they need.
Ooh, Ehome. They've smoked up and they're heading themselves right towards the Ancients. They're around the back.
Yep, because they're contained in their base, so the only way they can move out is by smoking out. So let's see whether they actually get this big kill, if they can actually get themselves on Liha here.
They're down. Weeha turning in the trees. Ah, they're jumping to the wrong side and Weeha's going to be fine. Blinks away immediately as soon as some of them reveal themselves in the lane. He is not risking his life for that one.
And, that's a wasted time from Ehome.
Yeah, Puppy got his Granite Golem.
But at the very least, if you look at the map right now, Ehome managed to get two wards out, so they have some sort of vision, at the very least, to understand where they can farm. So this is really important for them. So, like you mentioned, Puppy only gets his hands on Granite Golem, but he still has a lot of wards that they haven't really planned on, so that I guess they're gonna be waiting for the next Roshan, because it's cheese as well. Take wards on the map and possibly try to find Ehome's vision and deward it with the gem that they actually got from the Phoenix earlier. Those are the things that Secret are gonna be looking to do in the next few minutes. Roshan, and get map control, place their wards and remove the vision of Ehome.
And we can see Envy's farm continuing to just Charlie's got 2.3k now on top of the E-Blade Manta Star. Puppy as well was very close to the Greaves. He's just got the Recipe Gold. He wishes to finish that off, but yeah, next time for Envy. You expect.
I'm actually liking Guardi. To kind of spend even more.
I mean, I'm looking at the more. How did Ehome kill Envy?
They need to chrono into Lina Sun and into Sven Sun. Like, they need all three labels.
But if he begins to morph, I mean, it's still gonna take a lot of time.
It's gonna be difficult. So maybe the other option is, maybe you call, because you can't really ignore him. He's dealing a lot of damage. You chrono him or you stun him and you go for the other team. Go for the other teammates and you leave the morphing to last. Just like you mentioned, when he puts his morph out, I'm not sure whether they have enough damage to actually burst him now. Oh, so, and he's. It's gonna be hard as well because they have the swap, so it's not gonna be easy for them to just focus one target and just hopefully bringing them down with all the single target focus fire. They might have to just undisable him and go for the like a Venge and a Chen has to be primary targets of the Sven. I think the Sven needs to find and get the support first.
You're saying every time on Levin just trying to hide in the tree line every position.
He's been having a really rough game as well, though we talk about Weeha not having a good game, but all 11 is also not having a really good game. He gave up a few very big kills that we gotten in getting the Roshan the two times. And hasn't really been setting up big corners yet.
Giving a very easy way to speed, but speed that they do this is formidable and nothing that Ehome can do in terms of getting there in time.
This is looking really dangerous for Ehome. If they decide to take this fight and they lose the fight, it might mean they have to expend buybacks or lose their rack.
Yeah.
So just, I think the best bet is just to defend his high ground and, you know, because that's the best place it gives you vision over the enemy, and that improves your chances of winning
the
fight.
Yeah, the BKB on Morphling, Octarine now on Weehawks and Boga.
Alright, so it's
gonna be hard.
So hold on, they're gonna kill him right now with the BKB.
Oh, that's the thing. I mean, it is Envy, so I don't want to say he's not gonna die again, but it's gonna be very hard for him to die. But I'm not gonna defy Envy to prove me wrong. It is Envy.
But you don't trust him.
It's Envy, he's gonna do something crazy. But he's looking pretty good, and he's playing very well this game. Okay, net worth on the guy we just saw. Actually, looking at the net worth difference overall, it's about 20,000 advantage for Spirit.
Yeah.
It's just totally gone whoop.
They've been controlling the last 10 minutes really, really well with the Beastmaster.
They've had full map control.
Yeah, and Beastmaster immediately just completed the AC, so they basically have all the aura. They need AC, Bats, the Ancient Black Dragon, the Granite Golem. They have the Necrobokon, Beastmaster as well. So basically, they have everything they need to actually possibly to push the high ground right now. They just have to be very careful not to get caught by the Corundum. They have to be apart, especially the Venge not to get caught since Envy stop the carry out. So that means that they need to pay attention to. Envy is alone bottom lane, he's 3 heroes down here, and his teammates are forcing the top lane.
Hey, just having the space up here, and the fortification will come out from the side of the
attack. Look at the Deku Warrior, oh my god, it's electric.
Easy wraps down on the top of these, the range one here for the side. Secret and they need to come up with something, because this is just going to continue. Secret slow siege where they just send someone in like Envy onto one lane, pull them apart.
Like I mentioned, they're doing a really good job. They're not committing, because the only way they can lose the team fight is they get caught in, like, too many heroes get caught in the Chronosphere and they land a really good egg. So what they're doing right now is just picking them up, not allowing Ehome to go up together to use just the team.
Oh, Pyknife die with the squad, bringing CTY out of the base. Now to half an up and slide off the BKB the two time, the Chronos that ball at three. CTY fills in the corner, some rage will start taking him up. And Ehome, this is their chance to try and find a fight. Look at the Storm Hammer onto Pyknife die, the Supernova coming out as well. They're bursting now with the crit, they will find the kill onto the bench. They find anything more though at the same. See, Puffy's like, guys, I'm hitting the racks, boys, and Envy, he's down bottom, he's looking for some racks as well. 11 will start to jump on Puffy. Envy is continuing to push on the bottom lane of racks. Top lane, Weehar and Misery, they're looking for the melee, and they're looking for the fight as well at the same time. By the looks of it, Envy was able to finish off the bottom. Now he goes to the mid lane. He's going to be able to find himself a second set of melee racks, full sets of racks on the bottom and the mid lane. Only a little bit left on the top of Misery. He's gone in, Envy says, I'll finish it off, team. He goes in, that's been Mega Creep. Been Eternal, that's been Jackie Mao. And Ehome just called GG. That's Secret. Pulling apart Ehome, and that's got to be a frustrating loss.
You trust Jackie Mouth?
I trust in Jackie Mouth, because he can morph my link anytime. What a
that was a really well executed plan. They knew that the only way to lose the team fight was the agent is they give Ehome a really good chrono or a really good, like, supernova. So what they did was basically just